Program. So I'm very excited to join you today. I think that last talk was really on theme with what I'm about to talk about. It really set me up well. Just to give you a little bit of background about myself, I'm a PhD candidate studying microbiology and immunology at Western University here in London, Ontario. My supervisor is actually Dr. Gregor Reid, and I originally started my graduate studies looking at how lactobacilli could mitigate metal toxicity like mercury and lead toxicity in humans. But over the past few years, I've actually been working in close collaboration with Dr. Graham Thompson, also at Western here, and his lab members to develop a probiotic specifically tailored to bees, honeybees, with strain level functions to improve their health. So given that excellent presentation just given by Dr. McFrederick, I think that most of you are probably familiar with the importance of microbes, so I won't go into too much background detail. But you know, one way in which we're trying to leverage this potential is testing how strain-specific probiotic abilities of lactobacilli might benefit current disease management strategies in apiculture. So similar to human medications, which often come with a long list of potential side effects, currently used hive medicants also have the potential to exacerbate sensitivity to things like pesticide toxicity through inhibiting detoxification systems, as well as things like antibiotics, which can increase mortality to opportunistic infection by antibiotic-resistant organisms as a result of weakening their immune system. So overall, the risks are well known, and ultimately the use of these chemicals have been deemed to offer a net advantage to the hive. Nonetheless, there's been little to no investigation into the prevention of these known risk factors, which cumulatively can add to the overall stress burden of honeybees and may exert insidious consequences to their overall long-term health. So we chose to look at antibiotics specifically and that are used to control bacterial diseases. And this was because many widely used types, for example, like oxytetracycline, can exert both direct toxicity to honeybees themselves and potentially more importantly, given their broad spectrum antimicrobial activity, can have off-target consequences on the health-promoting symbionts found in honeybees as well. So to address this kind of long-standing issue, we wondered if probiotics might be a simple solution, given they're commonly recommended by physicians to reduce the side effects of antibiotics in humans. So what about in bees? What's the rationale? The rationale comes in part from some of our previous work using a Drosophila model, in which we show select strains of probiotic lactobacilli can mitigate pesticide toxicity and upregulate highly conserved innate immune pathways in insects, which together represent two of the physiological aspects negatively influenced by antibiotic exposure. Specifically, using our Drosophila model as a predictive high-throughput screening platform, we elucidated several strains of lactobacilli with promising probiotic potential, ranging from the ability to decrease organophosphate insecticide toxicity to mitigating pathogen susceptibility and improving immune function during neonicotinoid exposure. Thus, the beneficial effects associated with supplementing select strains of probiotic lactobacilli overlap near perfectly with the off-target effects that antibiotics are expected to have in the hive. So accordingly, we hypothesized that in-hive supplementation with the identified candidate insect probiotic strains would alter honeybee recovery following antibiotic exposure. So to address this, we first had to determine an appropriate method to deliver the bacteria to the hive. Essentially, there's two main systems currently used. I won't go into too much detail here as my colleague Andrew Pitek will be discussing this topic in further detail and in the next talk. However, in brief, we chose against the syrup-based delivery system as high osmotic stress is known to lyse or kill bacterial cells, and ultimately this would result in the delivery of non-viable bacteria to the hive, which is not what we want. So to test our theory, we designed a functional food item using the pollen patty delivery system as a backbone. So making this design as realistic as possible, the base ingredients contain the same three nutrient sources used in most commercial patties. In addition, however, we added three strains of lactobacilli based on our previous mechanistic studies in Drosophila. Each were added were for a specific unique purpose. So, for example, the first is Lacti-Kci-Bacillus rhamnosus strain, and it was added for the purposes of pesticide detoxification. The second was the Lacti-Plantarum strain, added for the purposes of immune regulation. And lastly, an Apilactobacillus kunkia strain, originally isolated from a healthy honeybee, and this was added for the purposes of microbiota restoration, and digestion. Sorry for slipping up on those names. They recently went through some taxonomic changes, so it's a lot more used to saying just lactobacillus. So together, we refer to this kind of unique combination together as the LX3 biopatty. So this is kind of what making the biopatty in the lab looks like, and pouring the biopatty, and finally placing it on top of the brood chamber in the hive. So finally, just getting to our experimental setup. Briefly, hives received routine oxytetracycline exposure for 14 days, during which we took pre- and post-exposure samples of honeybee larvae and adult nurse bees. Next, during the antibiotic recovery period, colonies were randomly divided and received either no further treatment, the vehicle patty containing just the base nutritional ingredients, or a biopatty containing both the nutritional ingredients as well as the three strains of lactobacilli. So we performed these experiments in two separate field trials here in London, Ontario, one in the spring and one in the late summer. A notable point to mention is that we included both a no treatment control group and a vehicle group to ensure that any differences we saw in the biopatty group were due to the added probiotic strains and not from the added nutrients in the base patty itself. So starting off, we first assessed the efficacy of oxytetracycline for its intended purpose. That is preventing the growth of P. larvae in the hive, which is the bacterial pathogen and causal agent of American foulbrood disease. So first, we measured the effect in larvae using a qPCR-based enumeration approach with species-specific primers. We found that the following 1 week of standard treatment with the antibiotic and onward, there was a significant reduction in pathogen load. So this was obviously an expected outcome, but it was still nice to see that no full-blown resistance had developed in our local colonies. We also measured P. larvae in adults, since they can act as large reservoirs of the pathogen in the hive. Though in this case, oxytetracycline was ineffective at lowering P. larvae loads, potentially suggesting that some resistance elements from core symbionts may be spilling over and providing P. larvae safe harborage from antibiotic exposure within the context of the adult gut microbiota. There are some evidence in the literature suggesting that as well. So following antibiotics, we then also wanted to assess the effects of probiotic supplementation using biopatty delivery system. So intriguingly, the results demonstrated that probiotic supplementation could further help to suppress pathogen loads and significantly beyond that of the antibiotics alone and down to near undetectable levels there. So that's essentially what that's showing is on a log scale. So it's essentially 100 P. larvae cells in each individual, which is quite low. So moreover, we also found that the biopatty treatment could decrease P. larvae levels in adult honeybees as well. So these findings are really exciting because they suggest that probiotics can both complement antibiotics as well as offer distinct advantage in terms of improving overall pathogen eradication in the hive. So in another set of experiments under controlled conditions in the lab, we validated these findings using in vitro honeybee larvae. So just really quickly kind of summarizing the results, we found that pre-treatment with the three lactobacilli strains that are used in the biopatty could significantly reduce the number of active P. larvae cells in individuals that were early inoculated with a lethal dose of around 10,000 spores. So relative to their counterparts, which were infected, but only received vehicle pretreatment, which in this case was just the PBS here. So in addition, we also found that P. larvae infected group that was pretreated with the PBS vehicle had significantly reduced survival with over 30% of individuals succumbing to infection. So this was expected. Conversely, groups that were infected but received pretreatment with the probiotic, lactobacilli experienced significantly improved survival, which was comparable to that of the uninfected individuals. So the mechanism explaining these effects, which I won't be discussing today for the lack of time, was determined to be in part through direct cell-to-cell interactions and inhibition of P. larvae by at least one of the lactobacilli strains tested. So together, these results suggest that probiotic lactobacilli by itself can both decrease pathogen load and also improve survival to P. larvae infection in honeybee brood. So next, we wanted to quickly look at nurse bees, and we performed 16S sequencing to assess the impact of oxytetracycline. Compositionally, the oxytetracycline exposure led to a reduction in a number of species, but more strikingly, a substantial decrease in overall total bacterial load in honeybees. So demonstrating the relevance of this, we performed statistical analysis using Aldex2 software and found that a significant decrease in several key symbionts known to regulate immune function and nutrient metabolism, such as Frischella perrara and Lactobacillus Firm-5 strains, some of which were discussed in the previous talk. So just a quick recap, antibiotic exposure lowered pathogen load and, as one might expect, also depleted crucial symbionts in the gut microbiota. What does this mean at the colony level? Well, investigating overall colony dynamics, we enumerated brood counts in the hive frame using a semi-automated counting method. Ultimately, it's a good proxy of individual nutrition and overall hive performance. So we demonstrated that oxytetracycline significantly reduced overall performance after 2 weeks of exposure. And this is kind of in line with past studies showing the negative effects of antibiotics in honeybees, and also the fact that, you know, thriving colonies versus non-thriving colonies have different microbiota. So promisingly, however, we showed that probiotic supplementation using the biopatties could rescue hive productivity, which became significantly noticeable after 3 weeks post-exposure to the antibiotic, benefits extending to the fourth week of supplementation. I'm running out of time here, so I'm just going to quickly kind of skip through these next few slides. We identified that basically the probiotic could improve immune regulation in the honeybee gut and select for or help promote the established core microbiota members, and did this through upregulating a number of important immune genes, antimicrobial peptides that basically play a role in shaping the microbiota. And this is in line with previous studies that have shown that a higher apidacin, which is an immune antimicrobial peptide, showed that higher concentrations of this apidacin were found in bees harboring the normal gut microbiota. So essentially, probiotics could improve immunity, increase these antimicrobial peptides that shape the microbiota, and thereby lead to recovery from antibiotics. Really, the key point summary of this presentation is that combination therapy with probiotics is more effective than antibiotics alone for suppressing P. larvae. Probiotics can mitigate antibiotics-associated microbiota dysbiosis and reduce egg laying by the queen, and these findings are not intended to refute the value of antibiotics or discourage their usage in apiculture, but instead, we suggest that potentially, you know, that the combination strategy could help increase the duration between necessary antibiotic treatments and potentially reduce the need for antibiotics and reduce the spread of environmental antimicrobial resistance. Ultimately, one day we hope that antibiotics could be dropped completely, but, you know, further studies would be needed. So with that, I'd like to just thank all collaborators that were on this project and funding agencies that enabled the study to be done. And thank you very much for your time. All questions are welcomed.
Thank you, Brendan. That was great.